But God does declare and decree that the letter does kill it, but the spirit gives life. We can't come into the word of God having our own mindset to what we feel that we are talking, twist the scriptures that's outside the theological or doctrine of what God has designed them to be. But even as we begin to read the scriptures, God wants to continue to get revelation, the wisdom and knowledge in direction in what Christ is doing here. As we continue to read and understand, and we may have good understanding about the scriptures and the word of God, we may come to understand and realize who God is and how he's calling us in the season which we're in. You know, the word of God speaks over here in the book of John, chapter 15, says, "I am the true vine." Just speaking about the process of the vine. Nothing can produce without a vine. Jesus declares and decrees in the book of John, if not a seed falls to the ground and dies, it can no longer, or it will not even have the possibility to produce fruit. Well, Christ has died for us in the midst of all our sins, all our proclivities. And we go back to the book of Genesis. We know that was the first Adam, which Jesus is the new Adam, which I always speak in retrospect to the scriptures. It said that was the first Adam, which, in other words, we think about the process. And I remember one of the men of God is a part of our alliance there in the city of Terrell, Texas. We talked about how that Christ, it being the true vine, but yet Adam in the midst of the garden, having the dominion, according to Genesis 1 and 26, had the ability, or has been given the ability over the whole garden, not just to be able to go in and handle it any kind of way, but understand the commandments God designed him to do. And God began to speak to him about the trees that were in the garden. But we go to talk about the tree that was in the midst of the garden. He said, once you bite of the apple, the tree of garden, in the midst of the garden, he said, your eyes shall be open. And his eyes were open, and their eyes were open. But one thing I heard the man of God say over there in Terrell, he said, when Eve bit the apple, nothing happened. But when Adam bit the apple, all hell broke loose. I mean, sin, it just radiated throughout all the earth. It came all a man's denial of everything that he may have said had to have in darkness or may have said all came to light because of one man's sin, and that was Adam. So we talk about the vines that God tells us not to eat of, and he talks about the vines God does tell us to eat of. God said he's the vine. Now we're to eat of the word of God, which is the fruit of the spirit. Know them with the love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness. We know all these. But God is telling us in the day and time to eat of the Son. And even when we talk about the word of God, when Jesus began to set the multitude in the midst, and the 5,000 in the midst, and he began to feed them with the really pistol biscuits and little bitty loaves of bread, a little fish, a little macro fish. And he did an extraordinary number to the point that it really revolutionized man's mathematical understanding, because he took something that was impossible and did he took something that was impossible and did the possibility. He fed 5,000 people, and then even as he missed, he fed them, there was more baskets left over. God gets the overflow in our life. We begin to eat from what is the vine. He said, I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit is taken away. Now, we got to really understand what he's saying there. We look at the point of verse 15, once again, I am a vine. Anything that's a part of something that's moving, has been died from sin, been free from any kind of disease, any kind of what we call a mold or whatever it may be that deters that vine from growing. If it's fed properly, it's going to break the soil, and it's going to move, and it's going to grow mightily to produce fruit. We look at some of the trees and some of the plants that go seasonal. And sometimes our faith is seasonal. Sometimes people have seasonal faith. But God don't want you to have seasonal faith. He wants you to have continual faith. Excuse me. Sometimes we have faith that only comes at a certain season. But the Bible says we trust in God and lean not to our own understanding. He would acknowledge the fact that he's God and beside him as another. The Bible says we have not because we ask not. You know, it's amazing. Well, I'm not gonna pull off of this, but I want to go back to the point over in the book of John 14. If you want to come over to the book of John 14 with me, and it really deals with the planting of the Son coming here on earth. As he came in on earth, he came as a representative of the kingdom of God. He came as a representative of a true seed that will now die for the remission of our sins, that will free us from the very bondage that the enemy tries to hold, has tried all these years to hold us in. So we think about the process. We go back to the book of John 14. We're going to flip our Bible to the book of John 14. And we'll just kind of parallel the scriptures and bring some of the understanding of the scriptures together, that in what we're dealing with about over in John 15. He said, I am the true vine, and you know how my father's a vine dresser. I come in representation of my father. I come to do the will that he called me to do. The same thing with us. If we're going to be a true vine of Christ, we got to be in the understanding, in the relation or correlation with the word of God, to the point that when we do the word of God and we walk with the word of God, we got to be an example for the kingdom. You know, the word of God says over in the book of John 14, say, believe it not that I am in the Father, and the Father's in me. Now, he makes a representation of himself that he's not coming in his own recompense. He's coming as a representative of the kingdom of God. We go back to the book of Jeremiah 1:5. You hear me say this constantly. Before God created you, before he designed you, before he engineered you, he gave you a gift. And he gave you a gift to be able to come down here on earth, not only to enjoy the pleasures of earth or whatever God give you. You know, it's not just because you don't have some of the nice rides or some nice homes. It's not God that don't want you to have. I mean, he wants you to enjoy the pleasure, but he wants you to understand first, it says in Matthew 6:33, you got to seek him first. Now, when you add and ask God that what you have, but yet doing his will, I believe God will open up the windows of heaven, as he says in the book of Malachi. He said, test me, try me. God is saying, in the quote of John 15, if you want to be a part of this vine, I got plenty for you. That if you walk upright, he said, no good thing will I hold from you. Now, he says in the Psalms 84:11, but we get a revelation to what he's saying over here in the book of John chapter 15. He says, I'm the true vine. My father's a fine dresser. Then he comes back over in the area of John 14, around the 10th verse. He makes it very clear. He says, believe it not that I'm in the Father and the Father in me. He said, the words that I speak not of myself, but I speak of the Father that dwelleth in me. He does the work. He makes a solid representation that he's not the one that's doing anything. He comes as a representative of his Father. He comes to do the work that he called him to do. I think we think about it in the Bibles. I want to look at something here. I want to go back to some of the things that God has continued to put on my spirit. And I want you guys to just roll along with me. And I want you to really catch what I'm saying here. And I want you to think I'm just a person just kind of ramble through the scriptures. I'm trying to get you to get some revelation here. So we take our Bibles and let's go over to the book of Hebrews. Yeah, we're going to look up the book of Hebrews here a second. I'm going to take it by on a taxi over the book of Hebrews. And I'm going to bring something here in retrospect to being the true vine, not only being a true vine, but understanding who God called you and represented you to be while you're here on earth. Now, he talks about the process of faith. We look at the book of Hebrews. We talk about faith. He talks about the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Well, if you're planted in the right place and you're planted with the right people, then guess what? You're going to produce good fruit. The Bible says that even when you begin to produce good fruit, he says over in Hebrews 11:2, he said, by the elders obtain a good report. Now, the word of God said, who has believed the report? According to John, I believe John 53 and 5. John 52 and 5. Let me make sure we get that. Let's look over there right quick and make sure we're not really stumbling through our scripture, just speaking of sin, something. Let's look over here in, in that actual report, I believe it's Isaiah 51, but we want to take a quick look and we're going to come right back. I always want to get the scriptures to the point that we understand what we're saying, that we're not just saying anything, it's to say things. And we want to make sure the scriptures that we're saying is lining up. The word of God declares decrees over here in the book of, John, let's look at John. I believe it's Isaiah, excuse me, ladies and gentlemen, Isaiah 52. Let's look at Isaiah 52. Doing a little teaching here before we get moving. We just kind of crank that up here, getting moving in the word of God. And we want to hear what the word of God here. So I'm going to kind of make some steps here in the scriptures. And I want to make sure that, but the word of God, here's Isaiah 53. Now, it makes a statement. Now notice how we correlate in the scripture. We're like an attorney producing facts about the word of God, not from what we call an educational point of view, but a revelational point of view, even in correlation with the historical rights and what we understand what Christ has called us to do. Now, the reason I came over here to the book of Isaiah 53:1, he said, for who has believed the report? And he says, who has the arms of the report revealed? The word of God tells us evil communication corrupts good judgment. Who you feeding from, who you're listening to, has a lot to do with where you're going. So we go back over here and understand that Jesus came in the midst as bringing a report from the Father. Even in the book of Hebrews, Hebrews talks about the process that even as the report begins to come forth, he said that it was a substance, it was an evidence of what's going on. It's by the faith. That even as by faith, we realize and understand that the work that we're doing here on earth is really more than what we can see. Now, I want you guys to catch me here. Don't you think I'm just up here rambling off? Because if you really have an ear to hear, then you hear what the Spirit of the Lord has to say. And that's going to look at it from what you call your book study point of view, even though it's things here line up to what we're saying according to the Scriptures, because we're not veering off anything, but we're speaking about revelation. We speak about information. And we think about the process we just talked about on the book of Hebrews. He talks about this stuff takes faith. Because the reason it takes faith, because he said it brings on a report, according to the book of Isaiah 53. You know, if you had a faith to produce the word that Christ has said he's going to do in your life, then guess what? Christ will show himself to have been approved in your life. He begins to tell us, I am the true vine and my Father is the husbandman. You know, he came to do a work, not of himself, but the one who sent him. And when he came to do that work, he had to have the ability to understand that what God put in him cannot go back void. That he's going to produce such a powerful report to the people that they cannot deny the things that he's doing in your life. I'm telling you, ladies and gentlemen, you understand the power you got and the ability God has given you. It supersedes far beyond more than what you can understand and even imagine. He begins to speak that very powerful word. As we go back to the book of Hebrews, for going back to the area of John chapter 15, he makes it very clear in Hebrews chapter 1. He said, look, God who had, let's think of Hebrews 11. I'm going back to Hebrews 11, which is a good verse in John 11. Hebrews 1. But we're going to go look at that John is on me, but I'm going to stay with this. That Hebrews over in the book of Hebrews, verse 11. Now, is this not in the scripture people just quote? You got to understand what it's saying here. He said, now faith. When you believe now, you didn't got to read the whole sentence out. It's now faith. The word of God says in the book of, the book of Psalms 46, he talks about a very present help in a very present time of need. Now, Pastor Ellis, what are you saying about the true value? Because I'm getting you to see how God is trying to attach you to being something that attach you to something that's going to grow. He's going to attach you to the part of a vine, that your faith is going to be the thing that's going to be right now, that the words you speak out of your mouth are truth. And when you speak the truth and the understanding, declare and decree that through him and everything and all things are possible, you cannot be denied. He said, now faith. And what now faith does, it produces what? Things that you cannot see, but it's evidence of things. It's, in other words, you can. Faith says it's already there, but in the physical, it can't be seen. Jesus declares a word. When we go back over here in the book of John 14, Jesus declares a word so powerfully. When you read this, he believe it not that I'm in the Father in me. He said, believe me not that I'm in the Father in me. Or the words that I speak not of myself, but the Father that sent, that dwelleth in me. He come as an evidence according to the book of Hebrews. Even though you have heard of me and you don't believe the works that I'm doing, don't look at me. Believe me for the one that I sent. That we believe me for the one that sent me. So what Christ is saying, that even as you as an individual come here on earth, you have been given the ability and the power to mesmerize men beyond belief. That through the signs, wonders, and miracles God has produced in you, that he shows you to the point that you got to move forward. And when you move forward, God will begin to declare the spirit that you need. To show the people that you're a representative of the kingdom of God. You don't lose me here, because I want you to see something. I want you to really catch this. Hope is evidence. Hope is faith. Me and I got an expectation. And when my daughter says, Daddy, you going to get me something? Yeah, I'm going to get you something. She said, go buy me a toy today. I say, yes. She don't see the toy yet, but she's anticipating, knowing that what I told her is going to come to evidence, going to come to truth. She know it's like I'm a God, you know, but not really a God. But what happens when she asks me for something, I'm going to give her just what she asked for, knowing that when she asks me, it's going to come to full fruition. Am I saying something to somebody? Do that make sense to you? That now faith is a substance, according to Hebrews 11, that I can't see it. But through the evidence in which I'm speaking and declaring, I know that I'm, according to Hebrews 11 and 2, that I'm going to produce the evidence and retain the report, that will obtain that report because of my faith. The word of God said, now faith is a substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. This is how faith operates. I can't have faith for something I can already see. Jesus comes with the expectation of knowing that he's a part of the true vine, that he comes to bring forth that as we as man and women of God begin to believe on him, we attach ourselves to him. And we become a part of what we call the husband tree, the main vine, which is God. You know, we come to grow more like him. We become a part of the stump. Jesus comes in representation as a part of the vine to bring forth more belief in the people. They become a part of the vine in which God has sent from the kingdom. He said, I'm going to send this branch down, and everybody that attaches himself to this branch, which is Jesus Christ, will produce fruit. All that I give him, I give unto you. The Bible declares and decrees that even as we go forth,